Here's a video I've been meaning to make for a while. Consider it your jumping off point if you want to get started making your own wearable tech. Hi, I'm Becky Stern, and if you're new to my channel, welcome. I've published dozens of DIY wearables projects over the years, from LED costumes to internet-connected sensor jewelry. Here are my best tips for beginners, including answers to common questions. Keep watching to get inspired and learn how to find the resources you need to build your project idea. Hit that like button and let's dive in. Speaking of your idea, that's the first thing you need to get started. Think about solving a problem or enhancing an experience, either for yourself or someone you know. Maybe there's a costume or cosplay you've always wanted to wear. The second thing you need is the curiosity, drive, and resourcefulness to learn the skills needed for your idea, which you do not already possess. I'm hoping this video will help with some of that by providing links to resources in the description and the article that goes along with this video. The final thing you need is some motivation to start and or finish your project, which may come from within, or maybe an event or contest. You are in luck because this video is sponsored by Autodesk, which is hosting a wearables contest on Instructables you can enter right now. It's the Make It Wearable Engineering Student Contest, and I'm on the judging panel. You don't need to be an engineer or fashion designer to join the contest, just an actively enrolled high school or college level student ready to bring your curiosity and imagination and document your build on Instructables for a chance to win one of the 30 cash prizes available. And there are special judges prizes for sustainability, 3D printing, and projects that use Autodesk software. Here's your motivation to finally build that idea you've had or finish up the documentation on a project that's already in progress. Autodesk Instructables is a community of curious makers, innovators, teachers, and lifelong learners who love to share what they make. So even if you're watching after this particular contest has passed, there's always another student engineering contest to look forward to. And the other contests usually have judges' prizes specifically for students too. Check out the link in the description for the full contest details and rules. I have published over 150 of my project tutorials on Instructables, and I also used to work there, so trust me when I say it's a great place to share your work. And I'd love to see it in the Make It Wearable Engineering Student Contest. Starting from the very beginning, it's important to evaluate your skill level and bite off an appropriate amount of new material to chew on, so as to not get too frustrated to finish your project. Work smarter, not harder. Ready-made battery-powered fairy lights, LED strips, and EL wire are perfectly acceptable materials, especially if you're not ready to take on microcontroller programming or soldering. But something you should most definitely learn right away is how to sew by hand. The most useful thing is a tack stitch, which can be used in strategic places to secure your components to your garment or other soft material. I'll link to a good beginner resource for hand sewing in the article that goes with this video. It's an Instructables class by my friend Jessie. If you are ready to learn some basic electronics, I have a whole video series that introduces you to everything you need to know to build your own wearable electronics projects. But I'm not the only one. There are several free electronics classes on Instructables too, and just tons more free and excellent resources online than there used to be. I recommend learning to solder at least, which opens up a lot of possibilities. Then also microcontroller programming, which opens up even more. My favorite recipe for LED wearables is a Gemma M0 microcontroller, some NeoPixels, and a small battery pack. It's what my students use every year for their Halloween costumes, and it works out great. Here's where I have to insert a warning about conductive textiles. If you already know how to sew, it can be tempting to use conductive thread as your first foray into electronics, but it's not actually easier than using wire, and it introduces some problems that wire doesn't have. Conductive textiles are novel for certain applications, but they do not replace traditional insulated wiring when it comes to power delivery and signal reliability. For example, I made a zipper switch using conductive thread and a metal zipper pull. As it passes by the two embroidered pads, it closes the circuit between them. I put one of these on my old TV Be Gone hoodie project so that I could stealthily turn off TVs at restaurants and bars. But the rest of the circuit uses traditional insulated wires, tack stitched in place inside the garment. Learning to solder is easier than it looks, and small gauge silicone coated stranded wire is super flexible. Let's talk about power. Wearables are almost always battery powered, and lower voltages are easier to battery power. For example, here's how many AA batteries you need to make a 4.5 volt pack. And here's how many you need to make a 12 volt pack. So if you're wiring up your own circuit, I recommend checking out the voltage on your product before you buy it. These days, you can get a USB power bank in a variety of sizes, and those are all 5 volts. There's some simple math for calculating the current draw of your circuit, which can tell you how big of a battery capacity you need. Rechargeable lithium batteries pack a lot of power for their size, but they're a bit dangerous to work with, so I don't recommend them to beginners. I know, I'm such a buzzkill. I'm anti-conductive textiles, and now I'm anti-lithium batteries. I won't let you have any fun. But from my point of view, there needs to be a good reason to put non-renewable resources into our hobby projects. Shouldn't be the default. For most wearables projects, a 3 AAA alkaline battery pack is the perfect size. But it's useful to know that lithium batteries come in almost every size imaginable, and you can always swap out your project's battery later if you need to. The next tip is to make sure you have proper strain relief on any wires or delicate components in your project. Think about the physical forces your project will encounter. Repeated bending of wires can apply stress to the solder joint, so you should relieve that stress by leaving extra wire slack, stitching components and wires near the solder joints so they don't pull apart, using heat shrink tubing, hot glue, or both. Stranded wire is more flexible than solid wire, which helps it stand up to more repeated bending. So when you want a wire to stay stiff, use solid wire. And when you want it to be flexible, use stranded wire. It's a common misconception that all circuits are ruined if they get wet. Most components and circuit boards can survive getting wet as long as they were powered off at the time and they dry out again before powering back on. So you can wash your wearable electronics projects, just take the battery out first and be gentle. I did a whole video about this a million years ago where I put some of my wearables projects in the washer and dryer to prove they still worked. Hand washing is better because there's much less agitation to potentially break your circuit. Certain components that can fill with water, like microphones, shouldn't get wet at all. But usually it's not the water that causes the problems, but shorted circuitry thanks to the water being slightly conductive. So if there's no current traveling the circuit when it gets wet, then no charge will flow where nearby traces are shorted by the water. My next tip is to get creative with your LED diffusion. Bare LEDs on wearables look a little harsh in my opinion, so it's nice to use something to shape the light. Lightweight diffusion can be made from fabric, paper, thin plastic, and 3D printing in flexible materials, just to name a few. I made a whole guide on LED diffusion if you want to learn more. I'll add a link on screen and below. The last and best tip I can offer is to document your work and share it with others. The online maker community is a vibrant place thanks to the enthusiastic people who participate. Future you will thank you for writing down all the details that are easy to forget later, too. Plus, it's good for your portfolio since it's a nice showcase of your cross-disciplinary skills. Who knows, it could help you get your next job. And don't forget the prizes you can win by entering your project in a contest, such as those hosted by Instructables. If you have more questions, I'll answer them in the comments. If you liked this video, please give it a thumbs up and share it with a friend. I hope you'll subscribe with the bell to be notified of my future uploads. Subscribe to my email newsletter and find me on your favorite social media platform. Thanks so much, and I'll see you next time. This video is made with support from my sponsors and generous donations from viewers like you through Patreon and YouTube memberships.